We were having dinner, and Kendall got up and went to the bathroom. But after waiting several minutes for her to return, I became concerned, and I went to check on her. I could hear her moaning in pain, and when I opened the door, she was laying on the floor, doubled over in pain. Immediately, my heart dropped in my stomach.
It hurt so bad in my back. I was in such excruciating pain that I just couldn't even move.
Seeing her laying there on the floor did scare me. I had never seen her experience that kind of pain before.
Chris rushes Kendall to the ER. There, doctors take her vitals and perform an abdominal CAT scan. The results are surprising.
The doctor came in. He said that he knew what was wrong. He told Chris and I that I had a kidney stone.
Kidney stones are small deposits of mineral and acid salts that form within the kidneys. The hardened stones can clog the urinary tract, causing intense pain in the back and abdomen.
I was a little nervous, but just knowing that they knew what it was good news.
The doctors then told us that the kidney stone was small and she would probably pass it within several weeks. There was a big sense of relief to know that's what was causing the pain.
3 weeks later, Kendall does pass the kidney stone, but the pain persists. And over the course of the next 3 years, Kendall is plagued by debilitating abdominal pain, nausea, and depression.
I wasn't able to do routine things, go out to dinner, help care for the children. I felt really bad I wasn't giving the children my undivided attention.
Being a mom is one of the most important things in Kendall's life, and this had completely disrupted that.
Kendall sees countless doctors, but to no avail.
All the tests were inconclusive, and the doctors were dumbfounded. And it was extremely frustrating.
Then, one day in late August, things come to a head.
Kendall had decided to take our daughter, Mary Vivian, back to school shopping. It was mid-afternoon. I was at work.
There, Chris receives a call from his wife's cell phone.
I answered the phone expecting to hear Kendall, but instead I heard a quivering, shaky voice of my 7-year-old daughter.
No.
She was extremely upset. She was crying. And she said, "Daddy, I think Mommy is dying." I had never heard my daughter that scared.
I was in so much pain that I could barely speak. It was one of the worst painful episodes that I had. I felt like someone just punched me in the gut. It was extremely intense. I just got really afraid.
I was scared not only for Kendall, but also for our daughter for having to experience this.
Chris calls 911, and 10 minutes later, EMTs load Kendall into an ambulance. Chris rushes to meet them in the ER.
She looked exhausted. She was doubled over. It was obvious that the pain was more severe than we had ever seen before.
Doctors run x-rays and blood work.
But the ER doctors told us they couldn't find anything wrong with Kendall. I was extremely upset.
All the doctors can do is refer Kendall to yet another specialist. But this time, the specialist uncovers an important clue.
The doctor turned to me and asked if her skin color had been like that over the last several weeks. I turned and looked at her and noticed that her skin did look a little yellow. He said that she appeared to be jaundiced.
Jaundice is a yellowing of the skin that typically results from dysfunction in the liver, a vital organ that aids in digestion. Jaundice can often be a sign of hepatitis or liver disease, both of which can be fatal.
I was really shocked when he said that.
All kinds of things were running through my mind, cancer, tumors. was scary and made us realize how sick Kendall really was.
When the specialist orders an MRI of Kendall's abdomen, he notices an abnormality on her liver. But to find out what is causing it, Kendall must undergo exploratory surgery. At Duke Medical Center in Durham, North Carolina, Dr. Jeffrey Basil and his team prepare for the operation.
We thought she would benefit from an ERCP. It's an invasive procedure where we take a scope with a camera at the end of it, and we gain access to the bile duct.
The bile duct is a long tube-like structure that carries bile from the liver to the intestines. Dr. Basil and his team sedate Kendall and begin the procedure.
The scope was inserted through her mouth, into her esophagus, stomach, and eventually into the upper part of her small intestines.
From there, doctors get a view into the ducts of her liver, where they stumble upon something horrific.
When we swept the bile duct, a flat, leaf-like appearing object appeared in our camera view. This object appeared to be moving. It was extremely shocking. We used the scope to suction it so we could pull it out. We were able to put it in a jar and take a closer look at it.
With the creature in hand, Dr. Basil and his team can identify it. And when Kendall wakes up from surgery, she and Chris are in for quite a shock.
He had a jar in his hand with something in it, and he said he had a parasite.
We diagnosed Kendall with a liver fluke called fasciola hepatica.
Fasciola hepatica is a type of parasitic fluke that targets its host bile ducts and liver. Inside Kendall's body, the parasites feed on liver cells and blood, killing tissue and causing extreme inflammation. There, the parasites reproduce unchecked, leading to her jaundice, debilitation, and the agonizing abdominal pains that have haunted her for 4 years.
I was so shocked. I just felt so invaded.
I was scared to death. Not once did we ever consider that the possibility could be a parasite.
The liver fluke parasite is a flatworm that can survive in the human body for up to 30 years. Although many of those infected with the disease don't exhibit symptoms, the liver fluke can cause chronic inflammation of the liver and even lead to the formation of gallstones. In extreme cases, the parasite can cause cancer of the liver.
But Kendall's prognosis is even worse than this.
She can ultimately die from a severe infection.
It was very scary.
It was hard to imagine our family without Kendall. She's the matriarch. She's the one that takes care of all of us.
To kill the remaining flukes in her liver, doctors put Kendall on a rigorous course of antiparasitic medication called nitazoxanide. But something still haunts her.
Where did I get this? The only place that we've been in the last 14 years out of the United States is the Bahamas.
While liver flukes are present in the Caribbean, they can also be found much closer to home.
Though it's most common in Asia and Eastern Europe, the liver fluke is found in over 50 countries, including the United States, and affects as many as 35 million people worldwide. In freshwater, the liver fluke egg hatches into a larva that then penetrates a snail where it feeds and grows. After several weeks, it leaves the snail and attaches itself to a piece of vegetation and forms a cyst. The parasite enters its next host when a mammal, such as a sheep, eats the contaminated vegetation. Inside the mammal, the fluke burrows through the intestine and into the liver where it lays its eggs. The eggs pass in the mammal's excrement and into freshwater where the life cycle continues.
While it's impossible to be certain where Kendall got the parasite, there is one plant in particular that is often associated with liver fluke infections.
The most common way in which people become infected with liver flukes is from eating contaminated raw watercress.
Although the parasite is known to be present in the U.S., it's also possible to contract the parasite from eating contaminated imported produce. After 3 months, the antiparasitic medication rids Kendall's liver of the infection. And today, the Cobb's family life has returned to normal.
I'm back to being the kind of mom that I want to be.
Since the procedure and her recovery, she hasn't missed a single function for either of the children. She's back to being the mom that she wants to be and the mom that we're lucky to have.